Today we're talking about builders building buildings.
Save your touch back.
Builders building buildings, builders building buildings, builders building buildings. A lot of stuff being built. I just had a great week, and I am exhausted physically. I could probably sleep for 12 hours still right now, and still be tired after that. But at the same time, you know, as Tony was talking about it too, man, I am spiritually just excited and alive, and going somewhere where you see so much destruction, and yet people coming together, people helping people, and hearing stories from homeowner after homeowner about how God's presence was there with them in the middle of that storm. And Tony's wearing the Samaritan's Purse shirt. I'm not. It's a little circle with a cross in it. And that represents that Christ is in the middle of all of our storms. And man, we got to hear stories from these homeowners watching their 17-year-old son in his car as it lifted off the ground and then slammed back down. And then, you know, and they're yelling as if they can hear him or hear them, you know, to stay in the car. And one family whose house we worked on, they had the tornado go over them, right over their house, and they went out on their front porch thinking that it was over because everything was real quiet and calm and still. And a few seconds later, it all picked up again. They didn't realize that they were in the middle, the actual middle of the tornado as it went over their house. And so they rushed back in. And just hearing these stories and seeing the destruction. And then the whole time I'm sitting there, you know, planning and thinking about Sunday. You know, Sunday is always coming around, no matter what I'm doing the week before. And God gives us these verses about how we are to build up, right? And even in the worst destruction the world or life can throw at us, that we are continually building. And it's beautiful. It's a beautiful, I don't know, the way it all came together. And I love the baby crying. I almost got teared up, by the way, seeing all of our kids walk out. I don't usually. It's beautiful to see all these children rushing off to learn and to hear the word of God, and that these are the ones that are going to be carrying this legacy on. That everything that we build together as a church, as people, as a community, that we're going to pass all of that down to those kids and hope and pray by the power and the grace of God that they keep running with it and that it outlives us all. What we've done and what we're doing for the sake of the kingdom, that it all really does matter. And so, well, we just watched a little clip from the Lego movie. And you're welcome. I was actually wondering how many kids were going to like stop and turn around to watch it, because it's a hilarious, great movie. But the reality is there's two types of people in the world. There are those that love to build things out of Legos, and there are those who love to tear them down like Godzilla walking through Japan, right? Those are the only two people that exist in the world. I am the second. Yes, I'm with you, Ani. So, in 2023, Legos reported a revenue of $65.9 billion, which is up 2% from 2022, despite a declining toy market. Consumer sales grew 4%. Operating profit was $17.1 billion. Cash flow from operating activities increased 1% to $15.4 billion. And the thing is, they're indestructible. If you've ever stepped on one in the middle of the night, it did not break, but your foot did, right? I mean, how do so many Legos need to continue being purchased? And they've never stopped. I mean, it is a multi-billion dollar toy. And why? Well, because they're fun. They're fun and they're popular. And they're fun and popular because there are infinite possibilities of creation and expression when you just have a pile of Lego bricks in front of you. And that people, by God's created nature, that we are made in the image of a creator God. I think that we by nature love to create and invent and design and build new things. And Paul is kind of getting to that point here in these eight verses this morning that Josh read for us. But rather than building a $130, which is the average cost, by the way, of a Lego set is $130, rather than, they're way overpriced, but rather than building a $130 Lego set, we are spiritual builders. We build with our life and with our church. And all of this text, it's talking about two things. What kind of life are you building in Christ? And what kind of church are we building in Christ? And you can spend your entire life, and we can spend all of our church's resources seeking worldly rewards and material pleasures. Or you can spend your life, and we can spend our church building an eternal home, things that will last forever. And the truth is, we are all builders. Verse 10, it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10, according to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, but someone else builds on it. And each one must be careful how he builds. Paul's saying, I was a builder. I came in. I helped build this new thing called the church in the town of Corinth. And he's saying, but other people have continued building on that as well. And every single one of us, each one of us must be careful how we build. Right? Paul's special mission from God was to found churches. And he readily acknowledged that it is only by God's grace that you ever do anything that ever really matters. Right? It is only by God working in and through you that he could be a skilled master builder. And he adds this word of warning that the quality of your materials and the quality of your workmanship that goes into the building of our church or into the building of your life, those things matter. Because more important, more important than the method of building is the foundation, which of course we know is Christ, right? Jesus Christ, our Lord. He is our firm foundation. It is verse 11. He goes on and says, for no one can lay a foundation other than what is being laid, which is Jesus Christ. We were working at one of the houses, I think on Friday, and we were kind of joking because right across the street was a house, and half that house was just gone, right? So half the house is there, half the house is just a slab of concrete with some like wood sticking out, and but you can still see their bathroom. Their toilet survived. If you are ever in a tornado, go and grab a hold of your toilet. It is one of the safe places, right? So we were kind of joking as we arrived, like, hey, if anyone needs to go to the bathroom, you don't have to go to the porta potties. There's a toilet right there, right? So, but the homeowner walked out, and he was, it was an elderly husband and wife, probably in their 80s. And we were working across the street, but I just went over and talked to him for a minute and just asked him, were you guys in the home during the storm? What's your plans? And they said, well, actually, we're here to meet a contractor who's going to look at the foundation and see if we even can try to rebuild the house. And talk about a good illustration, right? I mean, that is it. That if the foundation is cracked or bent or twisted, then you can't just rebuild the house on top of it, right? You've got to completely tear it all up and completely lay a new foundation. And it's true with our life that we, so many people are out there trying to build a life on things that are so easily twisted and cracked, right? Empty wells with cracks in them. But in Christ Jesus, we have this sure, firm foundation that if your life is ever to be stable and level and strong and indestructible like Legos, then it has to be Jesus Christ Himself that is the foundation of what you do. Why do you do the things that you do in your life? If it isn't because Jesus Christ is the bedrock and the foundation of it, then it will all come falling down on top of you. We're going to circle back to this a little bit more later, but once you know the foundation is sure and level and stable, being built upon Christ, then you can design the building that you will create on that foundation, choosing what materials you want to use for that building. Are you going to create a builder's grade life or a craftsman quality one? It's up to you. You make that choice every day in the decisions that you make. What about our church? I think back to the Israelites when they're wandering in the desert and God gives Moses this vision of the tabernacle and what it will look like. And they all then take all the jewelry and everything they had taken with them out of Israel, and they give all of these precious resources in order to build the church. Well, now it's not about these walls. We don't want marble coated floors here in our church, right? We don't want gold plated walls. What we want is you, the church, right? That we are the precious materials now that are being used as the church. Or as Paul illustrates it, is the building that we're building fireproof. Verses 12 and 13, he goes on and says, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, or straw, each builder's work will be plainly seen, for the day will make it clear, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what kind of work each has done. Just like today, in Paul's day, contractors built buildings out of durable or combustible materials. And in the building of your life, the durable materials are those activities that spring from a reliance on Christ and Him crucified as the foundation. Anything that you do for the sake of Christ, that provides gold, silver, and precious stones to your life and to the church. They add real and an eternal value to you as a person. The combustible materials are works or deeds done in selfish worldly wisdom in all of its forms. They have no lasting contribution, even if it's done to serve in some temporary need. Biblical examples, by the way, of valuable work would be reading or teaching the Word of God, evangelism and sharing your faith, or serving others in the name or for the sake of Jesus. Examples of works that will be burnt up would be teaching popular or cultural ideas not rooted in Scripture. Selfishly using your time and money on yourself. Or social work that excludes the gospel message. Also described as just helping people so that you feel a little bit better about yourself. And there is a day that is coming when God is going to expose all these works. All the work that we do here in this life is going to be exposed on the day. That's a reference to the day when a believer will stand before God and give an account for the stewardship of your life. Now that is called Christ's judgment seat. And the fire of God's judgment is going to test the quality of each person's work and your workmanship. But it will not be testing you as a person. Right, the durability or the transience of those works will become apparent. But this isn't whether or not you do enough good deeds to get into heaven. Right, Paul is already talking to and about believers here. They're already rescued and saved from their sin in Christ Jesus. This is about whether or not you will be receiving heavenly rewards, which he goes on and kind of talks about in verses 14 and 15. If what someone has built survives, he will receive a reward. If someone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, right? It doesn't mean that you don't get into heaven, but he will be saved only as through fire. Okay, so what is that trying to say? Well, the New Testament writer spoke of these rewards symbolically as crowns, maybe literally as crowns. And the point is this: it is perfectly proper to go and to serve Christ in order to gain a crown, in order to gain heavenly rewards that we may one day lay at the feet of our Savior. That crown is a symbol of a life of faithful service that we perform out of gratitude for His grace for us. And it seems, or it sounds at first, kind of self-serving. Right? But if the idea of serving God in order to receive a reward makes you uncomfortable, then just go and study the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5, 6, and 7. There Jesus teaches repeatedly about appealing to his listeners to follow his teaching with the prospect of receiving an eternal reward for doing so. It is okay. Jesus calls us and commands us to serve him with the hope that we will receive eternal reward. And of course, certainly just serving out of, you know, I just love Jesus and that's why I do it. Yeah, that's great. That is obviously the best reason to serve God. In fact, I would have conversations. I had a few conversations with people, and they would say, I just can't believe that you all came up here, you know, to help people like me out. And my response was always, well, I know that God loves you, and I know that God loves me. And if God loves, and God loves us, then I don't know what else I can do but come and help out my sister, right? One of my family members needs some help. I got to come, right? We come and help. That's what we do. Well, that's a great reason. The other reasons, too, is, you know, it's fun. It's kind of like a week vacation, because whenever any of you have a problem that you send me, I say, hey, I'm busy this week. You know, I can't deal with that this week. And hopefully by this week, you know, the next week, hopefully your problem is already taken care of and fixed. Self-serving motives too. But the point is, serving God in order to receive eternal reward, that's good. That's good. In fact, we're told to serve people out of not only our love for God, but also out of our love for other people, out of our fear of the Lord, out of the prospect of receiving eternal rewards, and out of the knowing that we will one day be held to account for our lives at the judgment seat. Now, I want to get into that for a minute, because that sounds bad, right? And if you've been here a while, you've probably heard this explanation, but it sounds like, oh, I don't want to... We think about, with the Bible describing the judgment seat of Christ for believers, we think about one day I'm going to be sitting in a big movie theater next to Jesus and my whole life playing on a big screen in front of us. One of my big IMAX screens, you know, with the extra, you know, bass and the volume. And you know, every now and then Jesus just kind of looking at us, and us looking anywhere but at Jesus, you know. That is not at all what this is talking about. And we need to be able to understand this so that we can forget about our past, put our sin on Jesus' shoulder, and move on with our life in Christ, right? And the Bible describes the judgment seat of Christ for one main purpose. It's so that it affects the way that we think and live, right? But it's in a way to motivate us to anticipate with joy His return. And so then to live our lives to please Him. And Jesus makes it clear, right? Romans 8:1. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus our Lord. There is no sitting next to Jesus getting condemning glances. Right? That our sin, according to Psalms, has been removed as far as the east is from the west. You will not stand and be judged for your sin. Jesus already has. When you placed your faith in Him, all your sins were placed upon Him, and the wrath of God was satisfied in the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. We just talked about it for the last couple weeks with Easter. Amen. So praise God we never have to worry about being held accountable for our sin, because I wouldn't want to have to do that. Jesus did. So the Greek word then used to describe the word judgment seat, there's one word in the Greek that is translated judgment seat. That word is bema. And the bema was a raised platform on which judges would sit to view and to judge over the Greek Olympic Games. Their job was to make sure the contestants followed the rules and to present then the awards to those who competed well, right? To the victors. The Olympics are coming up this summer. And while it would be wildly entertaining, and I would probably watch a lot more of the Olympics if the loser, the guy that got last place, got his legs cut off or something, that doesn't happen, right? We don't do that, right? You do not get punished for finishing last place, right? Everyone is celebrated for competing. And those who get first, it's a funny thought. Those who get first, second, and third, they get to stand on the podium and receive their reward, right? Well, that's what this is referring about, the judgment over the Olympic Games. That's what the judgment seat of Christ is. There will be no punishment. Right? That's not what this isn't you having to answer for your sin. We will never have to do that. Right? Our sin has been placed upon Him. And His righteousness has been imputed into us. And that now the only thing we answer for is how good we served Him, how well we ran after Him, having now been saved from our sin. How did you spend the rest of your life? We all get to heaven smelling like smoke. Either you barely escape hell by the skin of your teeth, by the grace of God in your life, or you show up to heaven with the scent of one who spent every day of his life battling and fighting for the souls of others at the gates of hell. That's it. Which are you? Finally, we move on this morning that we don't demo. Verses 16 and 17, as we talk about builders building buildings, we are not here to do the demo work. It says, "Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit lives in you? If someone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is holy, which is what you are." Now, Paul is going to later in 1 Corinthians talk about how you yourself, your body, is a temple of the Holy Spirit. Right? The Holy Spirit, God Himself indwells you, that your body then is the holy of holies, right? The presence of God. That is not what he's talking about here. It is true, and we'll get to it later in a couple chapters. But right here, that word, every time he uses the word you, it is plural. This is one of those things that are lost in translation. Because stupid English has a same word for singular you, but also plural you. And here, this is in the original language, here the word is plural. Right? Y'all. Yeah. Yes! We need a Kentucky translation. Yes. put the word y'all in there. Do y'all not know that y'all are God's temple? And that's what he's saying here, that he's not talking about you specifically. He's saying all of us, corporately and collectively, we are now the church. We are God's temple. And this is perhaps the strongest warning in the entire New Testament against taking church lightly. And I know, getting a bunch of sinners together is a dangerous thing to do. And then say, love each other and don't screw it up, right? I mean, it is dangerous. And yet, man, we don't want to take it lightly. We have the command here to spend our lives building up the church, serving and loving each other, right? That we together, before you by yourself are a temple, we together are a temple. We are where God's presence resides here on this earth. As we gather together this morning for this hour, God is here with us. That's a powerful thought, that the local congregation is not just a building, that we are a sanctuary. We are a holy place whenever we gather together, because God inhabits his people. He inhabits his church. And if any servant of the Lord does anything to tear down, heaven forbid, to tear down the church instead of building it up, then God will tear them down. This is a very serious thing, to destroy or defile a holy temple, which is now the local church. And here's my thoughts on that, really. We kind of hit on this because he's going to be hitting on this a lot in Corinthians. Listen, guys, life is hard enough for everybody, right? Life is destructive enough for each one of us individually, for all of us corporately. Life is hard. Go up right now to Russell's Point, Ohio, and you'll see life is destructive enough without your help. Let's never contribute to the destruction in other people's lives or in our church. Man, just build one another up. People have enough and deal with enough hate and judgment and anger and animosity through the week. Guys, so when we come together on Sunday, just love everyone else. Just build one another up. Encourage people. Life is discouraging enough. We don't need you poking other people while they're here, right? I mean, that's his point. Right? As fun as it is to be Godzilla, walking through the Legos, don't be that person at church, right? Don't be Godzilla. Be the person building it. To summarize it all, the whole text this morning, build yourself up in Christ so that you can then also build up the church, because your life really does matter. While we were there, it felt like, you know, I mean, it's overwhelming. The whole place, thousands of homes, they were all just modular homes, so like mobile homes, for the most part, was all that was there. And that tornado ripped right through the middle of them. Thousands of people's homes just gone, just laying on the ground. And we're at one person's house, you know, raking up their yard to try to make their yard look good again. And it was overwhelming. It felt like we are just a small little stone in a massive ocean. And yet, then at the end, when we present that homeowner with their Bible and see just the immense gratitude that one person had, it just helped you know and remind you that whatever you do, as overwhelming as the problems of the world are right now and how much this world needs Jesus, it's overwhelming. And yet every one little thing that you do in the name of Jesus Christ, it really does matter. Even if it feels like it doesn't. We did see an actual vivid living example of what it means to build our church and to build your life on the solid foundation of Christ with quality materials. While we were in Logan County, Jesus ends the Sermon on the Mount by challenging us, right? To build our lives on the words and the teachings of Jesus Christ, right? The person that does that is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the storms came and the winds blew, and his house stood, unlike the foolish one who built their house in the sand. And the storms came and the winds blew and their house fell down. Like I said, most of the homes in that entire town were mobile homes or modular homes. And they were all devastated, right? Just lifted completely off their foundations. A lot of them just on trailers still, and just lifted, flipped over, ripped in half, parts of the home just gone. Most of them permanently destroyed. And there was one neighborhood that the tornado ripped right through the middle of. And in that neighborhood, there was one house. If you'll go to the next slide for me, Ryan. It was just one and only one house left standing. It's right there on the left side of that picture. And I know it's kind of hard to see as it's pretty far away, but you can kind of get an idea. Everything else, there was a whole neighborhood in front of them, and it's just gone. There's not one house left in that neighborhood. And yet right there next to it is that one house. Go to the next one. We're going to zoom it in a little bit. There it is. And I took another picture from behind because you actually get to see from this next picture that unlike all the other homes that had no real foundation, and that represents everyone in this world that is just trying to figure out what is the purpose and meaning of it all. And they're just coming up with worldly ideas of what to build their life on. And it's nothing. It's all going to come falling apart on top of them. And the first time something comes in that really challenges what their life is about. But that house, go to the next slide, Ryan. Here it is from the back. And you see the foundation? That thing has a solid concrete foundation with an entire stone side on one side and concrete pillars lining the other side. And that held that house as the storm went right over top of it and completely annihilated all the other homes. And yet, look at that house. The house that was built on the solid foundation, it stood. And it had a little bit of wind damage on the decking. And on the shingles on the roof. Man, that can be repaired pretty easy. They never had to leave. They never had to move out. I don't know that they were still there. I hope not, as I'm taking pictures of them. They used those large rocks and decorative concrete to form that foundation. And I'm telling you, when the storms of life came, in the form of a half-mile-wide E3 tornado with 155-mile-an-hour winds, the house was not moved. That is why this does matter. It matters that you're building your life on the foundation of Jesus Christ, and it matters what you're building your life with. It matters what you do. Not just for God, right? Not just for the church, but for you. Because these storms are coming. If you've lived life long enough, you know. Storms are coming. And they're going to sweep you off your entire life off of its foundation. Unless you're building your house on the rock. And so, I have two questions for everyone to reflect on as we close this morning in song. The first question is this. Is Jesus the foundation of my life? Is Jesus the foundation of my life? And number two, what types or sorts of building materials am I giving Jesus to create with my life? Are the materials that I am giving to Him, offering to Him, are they eternal or are they temporary? Let's pray.